We can welcome everybody here to our broadcast, coming to you from the Joint Data Studios right here in Berlin. Even though it looks like we might be in China, well, we're not those people. I'm Toby One. I'll be your host for the English live stream today as we are doing our grand final ahead of schedule. All the other tournaments ended up wrapping up a lot earlier than we were expecting, so we're actually a full, hour ahead of schedule. Everyone's inside the lobby. We're almost ready to rock and rumble, and I'm not going to be alone today. I'm going to be joined by a man who has actually been casting the entire WC alongside me. He joined me for the games at the later part of the day, and we had the multiple games running. He was there flying his colours on Joint Data Blue, and of course, I say flying his colours because he's also an Australian as well. So I'm going to give you a bit of a howdy doody. How you doing today, Basecamp? How you doing?
Hey, Toby, I'm doing great. I actually managed to hurt my back by sitting badly for the two 12-hour casting sessions over the last 2 days. So I've been injured in the line of duty, but I'm still excited to come and cast this game. It should be really, really good. I'm excited. I think C9 and EG were definitely the two most impressive teams over the course of this tournament. So the double elimination format worked out.
Yeah, I'm actually interested to see how this all goes down, because if we were coming into just a straight best of five, I might have actually been backing EG to win this. And I know that's a really weird thing to say after Cloud9 has had such a dominating performance throughout the entire competition, but because it's actually two separate best of threes, it seems like such a hard slog for EG to get through all the games, while C9 can be sitting there trying new and different things, keeping with what they've got, and EG will have to do like multiple new things to actually catch C9 like off guard.
Yeah, there are plenty of things I think that C9 could throw EG's way. I don't know if they've managed to hang on to anything up until this point in the competition, but they did have the slightly easier road, so you know, maybe they still have something. EG do have a lot of momentum going into this game. However, they made an absolute run through the lower bracket, and I think if this was just a straight best of five or something like that, I think I would favor EG. I think their play has been looking a little bit more solid, and C9 are still having some hiccups here and there, I think, integrating FATA. But just with the advantage that they have, you know, with the format, then I think maybe C9 will be walking away with the win. It is really hard to call, though. I think we might be seeing, well, we'll probably see the bracket reset, and then it'll come down to the final best of three.
At this point, man, I would like to have the same prediction, but I'm going to lock mine in early and actually say C9 will take this 2-1 in the first set.
Okay.
I'm fairly certain EG will get one game off them, but a lot of it, like, I want to see how these boys are doing in the morning. Like, what kind of mental state are they in coming into these matches? Are they going to be like rearing and ready to go? Is it going to be like, let's just play like as we normally would in game number one? Because if that's the case, it's going to set the tone for the rest of the series of the day. No matter how we look at these two teams, like, we know Eternal Envy. There's classic pictures of him from ESL 1 Frankfurt, which show you just like how down he can get if something goes wrong. And if C9 lose the first set, or they lose the first game in a really horrendous way, picking themselves back up again and playing the next game without having like max amount of frustration is going to be really, really difficult. Where I don't know if the same is going to be said for EG. Like, Arteezy may just say, oh, we fucking lost. But then PPD and Fear will go like, harden the hell up, boy, and learn how to like deal with it and move on and play. I think EG like will be a little bit more stable on that front.
Yeah, I know some people were mentioning reading on EE's interviews. I think he had an interview with Ghost of Gamers and an interview with Liquid Dota as well. And just talking about, you know, people were mentioning that his mindset seems a little bit weird sometimes. I think he's got something very positive going on in that he doesn't often let the tournament itself affect him until, you know, it's over. But it seems like the environment in China can sometimes be a little bit harsh, so we'll see if that's playing in at all. I guess worth mentioning, you know, we were talking to the EG guys in the lobby, you know, yesterday, and I asked, you know, are they jet lagged or anything like that? You know, how are they feeling? And Fear made the very bold comment that, you know, he's immune at this point. So I think EG are looking pretty strong. And like you mentioned, you know, Fear and Universe are absolute veterans of the scene, and you know, they've been traveling and playing for a very long time, so I think that's a huge benefit for EG, also, not only because of the mindset thing and being able to drag the team back together if things go badly, but also just they're such ridiculously consistent players as well. You know, you don't expect to see too many mistakes out of Fear and Universe in this kind of game.
Yeah, or at least we hope not from Fear. He is a little bit rusty after all that time off. Actually, he seems to be performing quite well throughout this tournament. We've actually got the team profiles going on the main stage right now, and they're focusing on Cloud9. So let's actually just... I want to talk about a player who doesn't always get talked about, and that's like 3%. we had ourselves a load. And that's actually Aoi 2000. I know the supports have kind of been overlooked in this competition. In fact, both from EG as well as from C9, even though EG keeps switching up who their supporters are. But the supports from Cloud9 have really been on the mark. Like PylaDai and Aoi 2000, actually, I should probably flag the two of them together. The warding is probably one of the biggest things I want to flag. They always seem to like have the wards exactly where they need them to be. You're going to get aggressive, the wards push up, and then the supports are right behind to make sure they're going to be like, there's going to be initiation directly after. I almost kind of wish that like Na'Vi was actually still in this. I know, weird. Just because of like also what FNG did. Like FNG support for me was one of the highlights of this tournament.
No, I'm definitely on board with that. I mean, FNG showed us... I talked about this in a couple of casts. I don't know if they were with you, but FNG kind of shifted the face of supporting a little bit, at least for this tournament. I mean, it's also been happening because Shadow Shaman was getting banned and Skywrath Mage just making it through, but we've even seen a shift during this tournament in the last couple of weeks away from grittier support play, I think, in general, to supports roaming around the map for 5 minutes at the start and just being a nuisance to try and win the lanes for their cores. So a roaming Mirana or a roaming Skywrath Mage or, you know, just anything that can stay active by themselves for a little while just to tip, you know, what would normally be a fairly even lane one way or the other. And that's exactly what FNG was doing on his Bane and his Vengeful Spirit as well. So it was a refreshing change of pace, and it goes to show that, you know, even on a version like this, there's still so much different stuff that you can do. And when I say a version like this, I mean a version that's been played to death, right? We've had a very long time for people to work out almost every nook and cranny, and we still have strats that people haven't run in a very long time that are being brought back.
The rumors that this version's coming to an end soon. That's if you believe the rumors.
I don't know if I believe the rumors. It always seems to take a little while for a balance patch to drop after TI, so it'll be ready when it's ready, and we just have to deal with the awful pub meta that we have for now.
The pub meta at the moment sucks. Now, especially with the addition of techies.
Grumble. don't get me started, Toby.
Hey, dude, you're already down in Australia playing on the pub servers down there. Come on, that can't be good.
Oz pubs are okay. I wish the population was a little bit higher, but you know, you can't have everything.
Poor man. Maybe when Australia gives up League of Legends and comes over to Dota 2, you might be okay then.
Yeah, that's the dream, Toby. That's the dream.
But keep living it, man. Keep living it. Okay, so everyone's inside the lobby. We're meant to be launching very, very soon. Our normal series of production is introduce the teams, panel members talk for about 2-3 minutes, and then we actually start this one up. As far as like these two teams battling up against each other, like Cloud9 versus EG, is probably not the matchup we're expecting during the grand finals, but it's not a matchup we haven't seen before. Like these guys, actually, I'm looking through their last games they played. So they actually, like, right now I'm seeing a 1-0 and a 1-0. Like these guys actually spent a long time since their last engagements. Like they played on the 9th of July, which was at the International, which obviously everyone has to play in. And that was where Cloud9 came on top. But if you actually go back in history then, it took them 3 months before they played each other before that. And that was during Dream League, during the seasons of that. These guys are very sporadic in their games. And before that, it was the HyperX T2L, where EG took the game out 2-0 in that best of three. And that was still back with their old roster, well, the old roster now, which is Mason, Universe, PPD, Arteezy, and Zai. So a long, long time ago. But one thing that's not a long time ago is the game! We're in, boys! We're in. Woo-hoo. And we're launching. So it's time to get this grand final started.
The one thing that is a little bit interesting, I guess, to point out is that EG and C9, out of all of the teams in this competition, are actually the ones that have made the smallest roster changes out of anyone. I mean, Na'Vi completely changed their support duo. You know, every other team has made at least one substitution, and in most cases, up to two. Like Vici Gaming I've had a couple of, you know, two changes. So it is interesting to me as well, just to raise the point of consistency, right? That these two teams have played together, aside from, you know, one player recently, it's the same team. And I think that there's a lot of benefit in that.
Well, man, we're underway already with our draft. And I'm also going to say, man, avoid the keyboard. The chat's picking up the tap. Okay. Yes, but we're into our game. So we'll have our first set of bans already coming remaining. Out. So we ban out Skywrath and Doom coming out from EG. And C9, they ban out the Lycan, obviously, because EG's on the Dire. But now's their choice. Like, people have been banning Enigma early on against EG. Shadow Shamans being, like, the pick of the supports early on as well. And it seems like both heroes will be let through by Cloud9.
Yeah, so I wonder if EG are going to take the Death Prophet here. I think Cloud9 are willing to give away the Death Prophet if they can get their hands on their Nature's Prophet to be able to pressure the mid lane. But no, EG are going to opt for the Razor instead, so something a little bit different. So I think the thought process for, well, just explaining the whole Death Prophet, Nature's Prophet thing is that EG do seem to like the Death Prophet a lot. They've been picking it really whenever they have the opportunity to, and it is an obscenely strong hero at the moment. You know, Exorcism is just crazy. But I think the one way that C9 could deal with it would be potentially getting, say, like the Bone 7 Nature's Prophet and maybe getting Pylite Die on something like his Bounty Hunter and just applying as much pressure as they possibly could on mid. But looks like we're not going to be seeing it this time. It's going to be C9 with the Death Prophet instead.
Yeah, they get both Death Prophet as well as the Clockwork. And EG, they're pulling out something very, very early. Fear's one of his favorite heroes from both the past as well as from just yesterday, in fact. So this event will come their way. I'm fairly certain Cloud9 will be ready for this one, but it's also interesting to see they pick up this event. Going up against a hero like Clockwork, for example, moving in and out of those cogs is not something Sven, like, his movement isn't really that fantastic. He gets some bonus movement speed with the Warcry, but he's still going to battle around the Clockwork.
Well, it doesn't even have to be core Sven, is the thing. I think Evil Geniuses are primarily picking it, one, because it keeps their options open, and two, just because they really want the Warcry bonus armor against the Death Prophet. I mean, that's been the big comment about the Death Prophet recently, is just how obscene Exorcism is. Exorcism is on during a fight, and you can't even consider engaging unless you somehow can burst down the Death Prophet in the early stages. But, you know, typical build is something like a Yules into armor or Yules into heart, so it can be pretty difficult to burst her down. But I like this Ven pick from EG. It's sort of one way to help take the edge off of the power of the DP, and maybe even give you the opportunity to engage into her while her ultimate is up, which is something that most lineups just are not able to do in the slightest. And yeah, there's the Dazzle Ban as well. C9 don't want to give away the double stacking armor.
Also, because that wonderful combination you can have, that's an easy move in, then you only need one extra setup, because we saw the SD as well as Dazzle combination in previous games as well. And EG actually banning out the Visage in this game. Sometimes that kind of slips your mind, doesn't it? The Drow Visage combo, which you can pull out. It can just slip past you a little bit. So you ban out the Visage, and then the Drow normally will not be picked up by Envy. 10 seconds
remaining. Yeah, against, I think, Envy's MO is if Drow Visage make it through into the second round of the draft, he pretty much always goes for it. And even just having that, you know, it's weird to think, but there's almost a big positive to having people think about that, because you always get pretty much the Visage ban. I mean, there's also the aspect that AUI 2000 is just amazing on the hero as well. Incorporated into their Tinker strats and everything else, but it's just something that, you know, it's almost something reliable for them. Like, the enemy team effectively only has 3 bans, and we know we're not going to get the Visage, which is definitely something that you can work around with and put the enemy team in a more compromising position where they can't ban everything that they want to because they feel that they have to ban something in particular. But what else? Okay, so Darkseer banned out. It makes a lot of sense. Universe is an absolute monster on that hero. You know, some more targeted bans. And there you go, C9 stealing the Enigma.
Yeah, that won't get to go the way of EG right now. But this does start to open up, like, what Cloud9 is going to be up to. Mirana. So they're going to be running a jungler in this case. Cloud9's obviously, Aoi 2000, the Enigma, there's no questions there at all. That means Bone 7 off lane. And the Death Prophet, we still have a decision to make. It should be Fader in the middle lane, but we have to keep our minds open to the fact that it could also be Eternal Envy on the safe lane. So EG get a glimpse of almost all the lanes. If they just assume it's going to be a Fated Death Prophet, which is a like 95% correct assumption, then they can pick their lanes perfectly. Like Razor versus Death Prophet, okay. Remaining. You could run Sven on the top lane up against the Clockwork, no problem at all. But a Mirana pickup, when you've still got Bane or SD available in the pool, it could actually even be an aggro tri-lane, knowing you've got one other hero that's currently sitting in the Cloud9 jungle. And you already want to have that kind of early level fighting so you can move through the Radiant jungle and ward up all the Enigma camps. Wasn't it? Who was it yesterday that had every single camp bar one blocked by sentry wards?
Yeah, I think it may have been AUI. I remember there was a Zai Enigma game as well, but he got away with like only one camp being blocked from what I remember. So yeah, I think you're on the money there.
All right, yeah, but in that case, it may not be an Aoi. I don't think it was Aoi.
No?
Because I didn't cast the Cloud9 games yesterday. And I know this game was yesterday, so it had to actually be a Zai Enigma.
I'll see if I can go jog my memory. I'll have a look at the...
Yeah, I had a bit of an abrupt start this morning, so my memory isn't really kicked in properly yet. Should have seen me walking to work. I had a Red Bull can in each hand with an apple sitting on top of either. That was my breakfast this morning. It's the only way to start the day when you get a message in the morning going, the grand final might start 2 hours early. And just the simple word of fuck came out from my bed.
It's funny, you and Cap was complaining that he couldn't get anything to eat at the end of casting yesterday. Yeah, so he had a Twix and glass of orange juice, I think, was his dinner.
But all the bakeries open at 6 a.m. Except on Sundays, actually, and it is actually Sunday today. But the bakery is open at 7 a.m. On Sundays. It's a little bit later.
Okay, so Cloud9 take the Shadow Demon for themselves. It's not a bad pick, but they're only... So all of their scaling is locked up pretty much in the Death Prophet and the Enigma right now. So if this EG Warcry is going to be successful in taking the edge off of that Exorcism, then the Cloud9 damage output is actually looking maybe a tiny bit questionable. And looks like we are going to be seeing at least a Core Sven or a Core Mirana with the Lich pickup. And EG just going for every hero with a blue background right now. It's Team Blue through and through.
That's one way to look at it. I'm looking at this as a Team Passive. Like, that's what this kind of goes down to right now. With the pickup of the SD as well as the Lich, EG must just be trying to control up their lanes. Like, that's all this really has to be now. It's like, okay, well, we'll weather the storm. We think the Sven and the Razor are going to be able to deal with at least the Death Prophet in the later portion of the game. I still want to see what Cloud9 are going to run as their core. And the assumption would actually be a Luna in this game, even though that could be really crazy up against a hero like a Sven. And the main reason I'm saying that is because it's what Envy's been doing time and time again when they pick up the Enigma. It's the pushing power. It's just the pushing power through the towers. And he's gonna if he actually gets that and EG can't lock down the Luna, then the Lich can't do anything to stop the push. In fact, their clearance right now is still just like Stormbolt, Starfall, and Plasma Field. I suppose we can add Frost Blast into that. But depending on the time it comes, that may actually also be very ineffective.
Yeah, I don't know if EG are actually all that worried about... So I was also thinking the same thing when we got up to the Mirana pick. I was like, they don't really have a whole lot of counter push to sit there and spam back Eidolons and keep Cloud9 away from towers. But I don't know if they care. They have, especially in the later stages of the game, they're going to have 25 armor each. And that's just plus armor from Ice Armor and Warcry. That's not to mention base armor. That's not to mention Abassi, anything else. And I just don't know if they're going to be afraid of the Death Prophet at all. And I think for that exact same reason, I don't know how scary something like a Luna pickup is for them here either. They can engage into bouncing glaives absolutely no problem if everybody is that tanky. So I'm really liking EG's. AG's lineup right now, and they can probably even pick up a blink on their Sven to cover the initiation problem. So,
well, when all else fails, man, pick Tinker.
They needed magical damage. They needed magical burst really badly. I mean, we were just talking about they didn't have any. I don't know if they have much hope of killing anybody with physical. So, but the Tinker is definitely a nice pickup for that.
Yeah, he's gonna be perfect for it. It's also a great cover fire for the Death Prophet. So if you can get that Master Machines, like one Stinker is a Blink Dagger, and you can obviously just jump in the trees and get a better positioning out for it, and then March of the Machines right over the top of the back end of the tower, and that gives Death Prophet the space, like, physical damage to the heroes, no, but direct damage to the talents with an Enigma behind him, yes. That can happen very, very easily. So I'm looking at C9, I'm not going to say forcing the issue early on, because I don't know if they can really do that, but into the mid game, they're definitely going to try and keep EG trapped on their side of the map. I want to watch the warning position, and probably more importantly, I want to see the effect of the Shadow Demon early on, because he doesn't have a hero to combo with. It kind of feels like this safety net for C9 early on, in case EG get a little over-aggressive onto the safe lane Tinker.
Yeah, that, and I think they also just wanted to take it away from EG after the Mirana pickup. So it's okay for them, but yeah, I think there's also the block pick aspect, even more than taking the Enigma themselves.
They could have always just gone for something else. Like, it didn't have to be an SD for the Mirana. Like, a Rubick would have been a great pickup up against the Clockwork. Or you could have gone for the Bane. Like, there's a lot of other options, so I'm not as sure about the block pick for that. And Sand King.
Okay.
EG's way of getting around, I need initiation, but I also need to farm the jungle.
Yeah, and getting on top of the Tinker as well. I mean, we were talking about it in some of C9's games, that Envy, whenever he's going for something like a Drow or a Tinker or a hero that's extremely vulnerable to just being jumped on top of, then his go-to bans pretty much always seem to be the Sand King and the Centaur. So I do like this pick quite a bit from EG, especially if they're... It depends on what kind of build they're going to be going for on the Sven, but you know, even if they end up going double Blink Daggers just to try and hound the Tinker in these fights, I think that's going to be maybe just fine. A lot of this game, I think, is going to come down to just how C9 do in the early stages of the game, how the mech timing for EG lines up against the mech timing from Cloud9. Cloud9's is probably always going to be a little bit faster unless they get some substantial ganks down on the Enigma, and that's where C9 can get very scary. And you know, even for all of the armor and you know all the tactics we've been talking about for EG, C9 could just snowball way too hard and win the game in, you know, below 20 minutes. So it'll be a question of when EG can start holding those fights with the Sand King Blink Dagger, and how long they're going to be able to, well, how much pressure they're going to be able to put on in the early game.
Yeah. I want to give a shout out to Raul Basu, who gave us our answer, sent me a message on Twitter, and it was actually in the newbie game. Enchantress was blocked out almost completely, so it was in that matchup that ended up happening. Let's run through our lanes and get some bearings before we kick this off. So it looks like Arteezy won't be heading towards the solo mid. He's actually up on the north right now, playing as the Razor. He'll be head-to-head with Fater, of all people. So C9 are definitely mixing up their lanes here, as Eternal Envy will go in towards the middle lane as the Tinker. Alloy 2000 will be in his own jungle, which isn't really heavily warded. In fact, there's only one camp being blocked up by this ward movement, and they're already watched by the Radiant Ward, which was down very, very early. So Bone7 will be the bottom lane. He'll be going up against Universe, who is in fact playing this Ven. And PPD's going to be there to give him a dual lane. We've got Zai, who's moving as the Sand King. He's heading up towards the top lane. And he'll be in combination with Fear right now. So they do actually push Arteezy back into the middle lane. And I think that actually wraps up everyone apart from Pylion Eye. And he'll be the roaming Shadow Demon, who, again, Pylion Eye. I like how he does this. He just leaves some extra money just in case he thinks he can get to his boots in time, or if he does require early sentry wards. But in this game, he won't need it. The only thing EG are doing are watching the Enigma. They're not actually stopping his jungle.
Yeah, some really interesting just lane shuffling and everything going on, as you pointed out, with Arteezy considering going up top lane, but I guess EG had a sense of what C9 were going to do, so they brought the Razor back to mid lane. And overall, what are our lanes looking like? So Clockwork's going to do okay bottom lane, honestly, but it is going to be up against the Lich. And just dual lanes, really, which is, you know, interesting, especially given that we've had a 3-1-1 meta for such a long time. But we said it in the draft and we said it in the pre-show that the offlane dual lanes and just dual lanes in general have been a big feature of both of these two teams' play through this tournament.
Mm-hmm. Well, right now, the bottom lane dual lane for EG seems to be nice and strong, but Bone7 is still getting some good experience out of this. And the top lane for C9, Like, they get pulled over to the side, so they're denying experience to Fear, and there's not really a lot that Zai can do about this, because if he comes in close, I'd say he would get disrupted, but Pilot Eye going for a unique start. He goes for Shadow Poison at level 1. I'm interested to see why he's doing that. Like, I assume it's not a misclick, and he's just trying to zone out Zai, because there's this Observe Ward on the other side. It's not perfectly, they can't actually munch on this tree and get rid of it, so the vision's actually better. Or he's just looking at the pure damage. I'm liking this though, like, just the Shadow Poison coming out from the side, like, it's getting pinged out saying he doesn't actually have a disruption. But you'd think about it, what's actually going to help you? Like, disruption wouldn't help you on that lane. There's Burrow Strike and there's Leap to get you away.
Yeah, Shadow Poison though is an extremely powerful damaging ability, especially especially since they increased the stack cap on it. You can easily take upwards of 500 damage just from a few stacks of Shadow Poison. So that doesn't change Pilot Eye's build overall too much. He's still going to pick up disruption at level 2 now and still be okay.
It's the saving grace for when Fading gets initiated on. I'm really, though, interested to see why EG didn't do a proper block through the Radiant Jungle. Because Aoi is now sitting at just shy of level 4, and he's only 2.5 minutes into this game. And, like, Aoi is known as one of the greatest enigmas in the jungle, because he just knows how to transition nicely. He's one of the most efficient players. Surprisingly, though, I'm going to flag the fact he didn't pick up Midnight Pulse early on, which I thought he might have, to try and actually clean up this tree line here. Yeah, not happening from him in this game.
He might be considering going for a gank around level 5 or something like that, and the second point of Malphite can definitely be relevant. I know the trend recently has been people picking up the early point in the Midnight Pulse, but we might see a smoke out of him and some early movement. And yeah, there's actually a smoke on the courier already, so he might even be considering a level 4 gank heading over to mid, something like that, try and alleviate some pressure off Envy, who is getting harassed pretty hard by RTZ, and Tiz is doing really well for himself in this lane. 17-10 versus the 9-1 Tinker, who actually picked up his bottle before Boots. Unfortunately, he had the Null Talisman, so I think he kind of had to go straight into the bottle, but not having Boots against the Razor means that you're going to get crushed for at least the early stages.
I would flag, though, that Eternal Envy, if Aoi is looking to initiate onto that mid lane, it's not really going to work, because Envy doesn't have the extra points up in the Rockets. Because he's not saving onto his skill points. So right now, he's just giving huge amounts of damage over to Arteezy. But he went 3 points directly into March, trying to use the March to push out the lane and get the last hits in, and then force some problems for Arteezy, but that's not really happening at the moment. So Arteezy is just really, really happy in the mid lane, sitting at 23 for 11, up against a Tinker who is 11 for 1. And he's not getting stacks from inside the jungle. They may look to do the gank in mid lane because Bone 7 with a Haste Rune was looking to come in on Arteezy. And this is like the first time Envy can get like uncontested farm, but no, he can't even do that. Arteezy comes back in again, and they got him pretty damn close towards the hillside, but Arteezy not feeling too pressured right now at all. See, I don't understand how C9 is even meant to gank him. Like, it's almost like they should just sit back and farm up and still just wait for their timing, wait for the Enigma to come out with a mech, wait for Clockwork to have level 6 before they can really do anything on this map.
Yeah, Tinker's not going to do that amazingly in the early game, but assuming that everybody else in his team does alright, they will be able to start making some space for him, you know, later on. Once the Clockwork has his level 6 or his level 7, he can leave bottom lane and they can bring down maybe Pile I Die, even just to sit behind Envy and make sure that he gets some good farm. And once Bone 7 starts moving, the EG supports will probably feel pressured into moving around the map a little bit as well. So we won't always have this Lich sitting down bot and denying. And the way that the lanes panned out is really interesting, because EG's warding suggests that they thought there was going to be, you know, the Tinker on the safe lane, but then they sort of put two and two together and somehow realized that Eternal Envy was going to be on mid and the Death Prophet would be off lane, because lanes would be much worse for EG if they had the Mirana mid and the Razor safe lane, just because the Razor is that much better against the Tinker here. So I don't know what prompted them to make that adjustment, because we did have Arteezy running up top initially, but it definitely worked out. His build was a mid lane build though, so maybe he was just going up there to see if he found anyone placing a ward or something like that.
Well, either way, man, we still actually have a killless game 6 minutes in. There's a lot of Observer Wards, though, which have stopped this from happening. Like, Paladai dancing around the tree with Zai, but Aoi's now moved up to the top lane. Pretty sure he was, as you know, he was still inside the Fog of War when he moved up like that, so they need this disruption from Paladai to hit, and then they'd have to go straight to the Black Hole. That's the only way they're going to kill off Fear, because he'll just leap out and away. Right, that's the only other way that's going to go down. And Fear is not coming out far enough. And with the phase boots, it's really difficult for Paladai to get to. Okay, now he's got it. Disruption, let the hole go. He has to do it straight from the start with the Crypt Form as well. Fear, he'll have leap. No, he can't even have time for that. The Black Hole held him just long enough. The Cloud Nine will take the first blood. Zai can look for a Burrow Strike on a Pylite die. He's trying to evade the moment. The Burrow Strike goes into Fader, but Zai, with that ultimate, it's the Crypt Swarm going to get the kill while he's inside the Sandstorm. But it's a huge hit from the Death Prophet. The pause will come out. Envy's having some problems, but C9 is definitely not on that top lane. Fader's Exorcism just ripped apart EG's attempted counter gank.
Man, what an ability. It's just... It's really crazy, but... So, overall trade ended up being first blood and two additional kills grabbed by C9. They only lost their support Shadow Demon in the end, so not a huge loss at all. Really nice early rotation out of AOI, and as you pointed out, some really good awareness of where the fog is during nighttime. It can be a little bit difficult to know exactly what your opponents can see and what they can't, but managed to skirt the edge of vision and get in there. And also made sure not to be scouted when Fear came in to finish off his phase boots, which kind of made up for Pylodai getting really aggressive when he went for the first disruption. So overall, really nice movement out of C9 to start things out. And when they do this, they get the TP from Arteezy, you know, to leave mid lane, and that's where Envy can start picking up the pace a little bit more on farming. He's already reached 25 CS, so doing a bit better than he was at the start.
He was already doing pretty crap at the start, so... Any kind of increase is good for a Turtle Envy. But he's also had, like, okay, so he's got Ancient stack up, and there's obviously into the jungle. Once he goes there, like, we know what Envy does, and it's the way he plays his Tinker. I remember, I think it was, like, I was casting with Aoi one time, and we talked about the differences between the Tinkers. And one of the big ones that came up was the difference between Excalibur and Eternal Envy when you looked at the Tinkers. And Excalibur's Tinker, what it does is it hunts. It wants kills all the time. Every single time, it wants to kill off people. And then Eternal Envy's Tinker wants to farm and make space every single time. So it's two very, very different ways of playing. And one gets gold coming out from finding kills, but that means you need to get the gold at the very, very start in order to get your Dagon up, in order to get like your higher level Dagon and your E-Blade together. Okay, that's not a great thing. Well, he's back inside the game now, so that's at least one upside. Had to use a mouse and keyboard to get there. But Eternal Envy gets a lot more farm because of the way he plays, because he takes a lot of farm from the sidelines. The downside about all of that is you restrict all the farm for the rest of your team. So the Clockwork needs to be hunting heroes, and Fader needs to be hunting towers. And the Enigma tries to keep the balance by grabbing farm out of the jungle all the time. And Eternal Envy can't take that all the time. He has to give space to it if he's taking the side lanes. So it's just an interesting... It's a different approach that Cloud9 take.
Yeah, I think it's also just a lot to do with the climate of the team. You know, if we're talking about Fnatic with Excalibur and we're talking about Eternal Envy on C9, when Fnatic were picking Tinker, it was very expressly, okay, we're picking Beastmaster and Tinker, and we are using him for the global pickoff, and, you know, that was the objective. On Envy's farming tendencies, it seems to me that, in general, C9 are a team that thinks a lot about how they're, you know, distributing the farm every minute. Like, there was a game, I guess it must have been the winner bracket finals that I was casting, and C9 were ahead, and they were just being ruthlessly efficient with how they cleared out the map. If you looked at it minute to minute, they were clearing out both jungles, both sets of ancients, and all three lanes every single time. So, and while Envy does take a lot of farm when he's given the opportunity to, and I think in this game he definitely will, because they have two pretty farm independent heroes in the Clockwork and the Shadow Demon, but I've also seen him in the past on his Tinker create a lot of space for other people to farm, where he, you know, focuses primarily on just one lane and maybe the opponent's jungle, and then frees up the other two lanes and his team's own jungle for the rest of his cores to grab farm. So I think just in general, the farm awareness on C9 is really good.
Well, we're back inside the game. Looks like Eternal Envy has managed to find his limbs. And we'll be able to keep moving in this game. So a great start to C9. They hit 1600 on the gold advantage now because of this. And their experience advantage actually capped up 2.1k. And Fader's even using the remainder of his exorcism just to do some chip damage on the tower with a catapult. But with also the conversions on the side, Fear is not sure about this top lane. Well, at least he'll be able to farm up a couple of them. And now he's backing up. He got the kill with the black hole. That's all he needed to do. Now he goes back into the jungle. Heaps the stacking of the Ancients happening, even though, oh, they're bugged out. This Ancient Thunderhide's in the wrong position. They've got to farm it now. They can't stack this thing anymore.
Yeah, it's not bugged. This is what happens when you damage the Thunderhide while you try and pull it, because then it casts Frenzy and it gets stuck. So it's a bit weird, but that's how it goes.
Pilot Eyes come up here for Zai. You can see him, moves around the corner, throws the poison, and Zai try to look through the tree line to find him, but they just juke each other for a moment. But they put down the sentry ward, so This is another one of those things I was talking about from Cloud9 that I want to just flag the supports for, and I want to keep a close eye on. Look at their ward positioning right now. You've still got a fresh, aggressive observant ward on the top, watching the movement of Fear and anyone that's coming close to that top lane. You've got a ward that's watching the movement up towards the top as well as the top rune, and then you throw down a sentry ward to block the SK from stacking. So they're making sure they're shutting down what EG are trying to find, which is their timings. The timings on the SK Blink Dagger won't be able to come. He's going to attempt to stack right now, and this wastes Zai's time. He doesn't want to have this happen. The only lane which is left to fend for itself is the bottom lane, but they've actually switched their lanes up there too. So Death Prophet is now down there, and Bone 7 comes up to the top. Because Bone 7 at least can control the Mirana. Having to turn to leap could be the death of her with that battery assault at level 3. She'll never be able to actually get the full turn off and then be able to get to the leap without taking at least 2 or 3 hits from that battery assault.
Yeah, something else that C9 supports, I mean, you're talking about their warding, and later to that point, something that they're really good at is making sure that their wards are pretty much always down first on the second batch to make sure that they see the opposing supports coming out and where exactly they're placing their wards, which is exactly what happened over at mid lane. They had their Radiant Ward down, so now they know that this Dire Observer is there.
Fortification has to come out from EG. They're trying to stop the push from C9, another reason why Fader and Aoi moved to the bottom lane. That's just an Exorcism and Conversion push, and the tower's already down to 240 of its life points. They'll back up so it doesn't come within deny range, which means next time they push, they just melt straight through the tower and can look towards the next tower as well, depending on how strong their push is by then. Which will probably be stronger considering the Black Hole is back off cooldown again for Aoi. But they don't actually have their Exorcism, so they are coming in a little bit earlier for this. But what's Universe really supposed to do on this offlane? The only thing he could do, which he did before, was Stormbolt the Creep Wave and get rid of it.
Yeah, this is just EG slowing the push down. This is not that one big fight where they will invest everything to start turning around the pace of the game. And that big fight will probably be, it might not be for a while, it might not even be to the tier 2s. I was about to say that maybe they could do it when they had double blink up on Universe and Zai, which is actually not too far away. They're both being really efficient with their early game farm, but they might want to grab maybe a mech on Arteezy if at all possible, though it does look like he's going for a drum build perhaps instead. I think that's a bracer for him, yeah, getting shipped out right now.
I'm actually wondering who does go that mech, considering, well, I would assume it's actually going to be the Sand King after he gets a Blink Dagger. Give him a little bit more space to farm up and then he can pick it up. Because Universe got his own Blink Dagger. So EG's going for double jump. No tank up the Sven with BKBs and stuff like that. It's get Sven on the front lines, let him be the initiator. And he's probably also going to be the only man right now that can cancel the black hole of Enigma. Because when you think about it, like, you got the Frost Nova, which can, the Chain Frost that can come out from PPD. Now that's going to affect the Enigma, BKB or not. So that's a great ability. But if he gets caught, Sven's the only person who can reposition himself to get the stun off without actually being caught inside the black hole. Maybe the SK on the edge, but even then, they need to wait for this Great Wave to push out before he can buy a Blink Dagger in secret.
Well, there's nothing secretive about what's happening top lane. This Radiant Ward was super value. It spotted Universe coming up here, though he's actually TP'd down bot, yep. So they don't expect him to be here.
Nice end of defensive disruptions. There's no follow through onto Aoi. The burrow strike, however, from Zai, putting that blink dagger to use. Then the chain frost bouncing through Cloud 9, taking out the Enigma and the Death Prophet. The bottom tower still went down, and Bone 70's not finished yet. Battery Assault with the cogs up. He's got Sandstorm from Zai, but then again with the Sentry World, they can see him, but he's trying to run himself away, but not enough speed. The Frost Blast slowing him down too much, and Pylai die. Disruption was still on cooldown, so he could not help. So they just fed Fear a double kill, and the only thing EG lost was the Sand King, who really made that happen. Without that double Burrow Strike, that never would have been as good.
If he hadn't Burrow Struck the Enigma as well, the mech would have gone off. And that would have been a completely different fight. The other aspect, of course, is what I was just talking about, that C9 saw Universe coming up towards top lane with this ward that they have down that's just about to fade. But Universe actually just walked top, and then he immediately TP'd bot. And I don't know if C9 expected Universe to be there, though I guess they did expect their mech to go off, and that was the biggest factor. So very well played there by Zai. Yeah, EG already starting to make C9 fight for these tier 1 towers, which is always a good sign for them. Talking about the mech, I don't know if the Sand King will be picking it up, but now that Zai has his blink, he can start doing the supporting and
now he's in trouble.
Maybe glitch.
First Pyro Strike, and he uses this mini blink, and then Universe just walks in behind. The mech charge to go this time, and he goes for the double black hole. Envy will come in, laser, they need more help, and Arteezy, he's actually trying to break down Eternal Envy now, and successful at doing so. Zai Pyro Strikes, and there it goes! The Enigma, the Midnight Pulse was still there to kill off the Sand King. Sorry, my name's around the wrong way. Then Bone 7, Hookshot tries to, actually completely misses it. And Arteezy just stood there with Eye of the Storm.
And Fear.
And they gave him a triple kill. Faders away. One chart just will keep him alive. Fear won't finish the job.
That was so close. That was so close to being a full team wipe in two different locations on the map. I think Bone 7 maybe could have canceled that TP mid. When he came in, he just, you know, he got absolutely slapped down by the DD Arteezy. So. Really nicely done out of EG. The double blink dagger is already doing work and really preventing C9 from grouping up too much more. I mean, C9 have some tier 1 gold lining their pockets, but I don't know how much longer they're going to be holding onto that gold lead, especially since it looks like EG are already in a position to start taking some more fights.
Mm-hmm. And how I was talking about the fact, like, if EG got beaten heavily in the first game, then they'd have real trouble just winning the full best of three. Right now, it's the complete opposite. Nemby's dead. I don't know what he's trying to achieve right now. He wanted to force the middle lane up, but he had to know there was Observer Wards down. Like, he even had his own Observer Ward down watching after him.
Bone
now
seven.
Up on top bye-bye. Lane, the clockwork goes down to a Mirana. This is a catastrophe for Cloud9. Middle tower is under attack.
EG just finding the pickoffs, and this game is getting out of control really quickly for C9. I die.
Just walked into it. They're pushing up the top lane. They didn't even have to blink for it. It was just a straight Burrow Strike and Storm Bolt. And the SD had no time to react. The lines are now starting to be drawn by Aoi. He's like, yo guys, don't go past it. Actually, even with that line, I think, yeah, you could even ping out from the SD and say, I didn't go past that line. But still, this is crippling. Like, the fact that Envy has also died two times within the space of 2 minutes, his blink dagger has been completely shut down. Not to mention, he was the main hero they pumped money into for Cloud9. He needed to keep the space up with the March of the Machines. He needed to stop EG from being able to do things like they did on top lane, taking tier 1 towers and pushing further. At the same time, if C9 just chill the fuck out, they're gonna be okay. Because they're still playing with a Tinker and Enigma. With a Crop. That's still their advantage here in the draft.
Yeah, if they can ever group up and push, they can still definitely siege some towers. But the question is whether or not Universe and Zai are ever going to give them that opportunity. Because, yeah, I don't know if that's gonna happen. It looks like somebody dropped poor PPD's headdress recipe, I think, onto the ground. So we ended up buying another one. So there's now just a random headdress recipe hiding here behind the trees. So I don't know what exactly happened there, but. It looks like the call is from EG just going to be, okay, Zai can start buying the wards and whatnot, and PPD can start working towards the mech, which is, I think, going to work out just fine. They've already maxed out Frost Armor as well, just to protect their towers from the Exorcism and the Eidolons. So again, I don't know what the Exorcism is going to be doing for C9 in teamfights or in pushes, especially with the Lich and Sven.
Zai and Universe, I can't take my eyes off these guys, man. Like, you said it right before where you said, these boys... They're the ones that restrict the space of Cloud9. And they're already coming to bottom lane. So Fear's pushing the tower. Not a single hero of Cloud9 is here. Envy is currently doing the ancient stack. So he's finding his money, and this will give him his blink dagger at least, so there's this maneuverability for Eternal Envy. There's none of these, like, I'm gonna walk up the middle ramp, past the tier 1 tower, and then go into trees, like, kind of thing. It's a, I'll just blink, do it, rearm, blink again, go safer, and stay in the trees without walking into them.
Yeah, and looks like C9 are gonna attempt a little bit of a group up and push. Now that they have this blink dagger, they can lay down some arches, but... if this push doesn't work out, then you already have to be feeling very, very worried for C9.
This is going to be C9's bread and butter. The martial machines cover fire with the exorcism to push, and the conversion army being the bulk of the hitting force behind it. Fader, he's actually getting a Yule Scepter off the Razor. He can go straight for the Silence, and then with the Crypt Swarm, just making him a little bit more injured. But then Fader, getting stunned up. There's still a big martial machine, a defensive disruption from Pilot Eye. Probably not really required, but I think he was worried about the Sand King follow-up more than anything else. And Envy, okay, that's an aggressive TP. But the mid tower, the catapult versus heroes, and it looks like Cardi's gonna lose here. The Lich will deny the tower with his wonderful 83 base damage. But EG have now lost all their tier 1 towers, so upside.
That was really good for EG. They defended with 4, they made C9 feel scared about engaging heavily and forcing the last hit. Fear got some damage on the tier 2 bottom lane in the meantime, and also secured some really nice farm for himself. So the Mirana pick is also doing just exactly what it's supposed to do, and split push and, you know, pressure C9 into making decisions, or at least keeping Envy pogoing from lane to lane more than... you know, as much as possible, and that's where you get the opportunities to maybe pick him off with a smoked Sand King or a smoked Sven.
I can understand your point there, man. At the same time, a smoked Sand King, smoked Sven. I'm waiting for, like, maybe I have to wait even longer for that. Like, they're taking Roshan for the moment, but I was thinking maybe C9 could initiate. They put an aggressive Observe Ward up inside the Dire Side jungle, so at least they can see the SK's movements, but it's not really going to help them, is it? Because they don't have an initiator. They got no one that can actually grab the SK out of Sandstorm apart from a Clockwork Hookshot, a Silence from the Crob, or an Enigma with Black Hole. That's the only things they've got against the SK. And I'm actually, in hindsight, that might also be the reason why the SD decided to go Shadow Poison level 1. Because it's the only thing that would affect the Sand King at level 1. Clockwork, big hook in by Bone 7. Turns on the Blade Mail. Universe doesn't want to hit him right now. He's actually stopping himself, but that means he just dies underneath the tower. Arteezy perched up, trying to run away. The Moonlight Shadow's down. They put the Sentry Wards and the Dust to be triggered, and Arteezy thinks he's safe. But the Rockets are coming in. That's enough damage. The Aegis Immortal will be triggered. The SK's up in the air. Fader, still going with the Silence. The arrow's coming in from Fear. They'll all manage to evade as they group back up for the mech from Aoi. But they burn the Aegis and they burn the Sven. And they defend the T1 tower, Cloud9 for now.
That was kind of sloppy from EG. I mean, I think they're feeling pretty confident with the way that the game is playing out, but that was... Yeah, they didn't have anybody else in the neighborhood. It was just Arteezy and Universe, and Universe got blown up pretty quickly with his Mask of Madness active. So looks like EG is going to have to just slow things down. A touch. I don't think C9 are really going to be looking for a full team fight until they at least maybe now they can, that they have the Dagon on Eternal Envy, but they definitely want a bit more magical burst because again, physical is just not going to be working for them. AOI is banking up some gold, 2100 for him right now. Not sure exactly what he's going to be heading into though. We'll see. Arteezy hookshotted on mid.
Yeah, you're right. Bone 7's on him. At the same time, Arteezy stole 84 points of damage. Now in comes Universe. Quick Yule Scepter. Evades a point-blank Stormbolt there, Fader. Yeah, that was quick. That was a very quick double tap.
I didn't even hear the animation of the Stormhammer. It was that short range, but very nicely done.
It was quick, man. It was quick. Same with Zai. Zai actually blinked himself away from the Rockets of Envy, because Envy was using the conversions of Aoi 2000 to TP onto, and this Observer Ward that's just sitting down here gave vision of the Sand King moving back up that direction. And because of that, he just came in, he TP'd into the lane, popped the Rockets, and then blinked himself directly down to get a follow-up laser and Dagon hit, and that would have been the death of the Sand King. The Sand King, luckily, he also had his own ward there and got just a split-second notification that it was coming. And he also double-tapped the Blink Tag because he got sent directly back into the fountain area.
Envy living life on the edge right now.
He actually got spotted there. He's in a position where he can be seen when he TPs to that point. But the March of the Machines is just meant to keep the creep waves back. This is what I talked about too with Eternal Envy. He won't gain a lot of experience from this, but what he does is make sure the lanes are always pushed out. Goodbye, SD. He's a long way out in that bottom lane. But he's a space creator, this Tinker. He's not meant to be a killer. He's a killer if he sees it, but he's mainly a space creator.
Yeah, he can look for opportunities if Bone7 or Fata manages to find somebody with Hookshot or Yules, but for the most part, you're right, he is just going to be spending a lot of time farming up and trying to get into his... I guess just get into his Ethereal Blade and Dagon. I think that needs to be the build for him here. Because he is the primary damage dealer for his team. Also, that the Shadow Poison should be pretty good here, though EGR moving pretty quickly into picking up, you know, mech and some casual cloaks here and there as well.
He's right next to Zai. Zai goes into Sandstorm. He could technically turn around for a Burrow Strike, Effie, but decides not to be part of that one. He was just staying in the trees where he thought it was safe. And doing something very, very similar that, well, I'm not going to say that Envy always does, but it just adds a lot of pressure towards the bottom lane. You stay in the trees, you watch the creep wave push out, you release an experience range, and the second it pushes out just a little bit too far, you go up there, you farm it up, and because he's got a Sandstorm and Blink Dagger and Burrow Strike, he's going to have enough confidence that he'll be okay here. I don't think that was the right button to hit, but because he knows he can just push the lane. So he's all good for that. I'm not so sure about this this build coming up from Aoi. He's actually going to go into the BKB. So we've got two BKBs arriving for C9. The Crop has already got hers, and the BKB is there for Aoi. And the primary reason why I'm not so sure about the BKB is just because of the amount of physical DPS coming out from Zven. It's going to hurt like hell. Zai. Oh, Envy. That's the reason why he stayed in the trees. Zai wafts the epicenter on the bottom lane. But the black hole's still gonna be cancelled by Chain Frost, no matter what Aoi does. So why not just go for Blink Dagger instead?
Because it's less about the black hole not being cancelled, and it's more about just living through the fights. There's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of lockdown, and there's a lot of...
Jumps middle lane, he's on Arteezy, the Blade Mail's already up, so Arteezy can't attack in. The Burrow Strike goes through Aoi, but the Midnight Pulse is already down. And the Shadow Demon ensures the Razor's death. PPD on the run, Bone7 can't catch up to him. And the SD's too far away, but that hero can. Tinker jumping up, goes for the Rockets, but PPD just got himself around the tree line, and the Burrow Strike, it comes in. The SD Disruption, saving some space for Aoi. He's already used the mech, and they're bailing out of here, but not fast enough. Cloud9 being punished for the chase on PPD. 3 for the price of 1 ends up being the trade score in the mid.
And overextensions on both sides. Arteezy a little bit too far forward given the position of his teammates, but C9 end up going into a headlong charge towards the tier 2, which they do end up being punished for. Nice arrow out of fear as well onto Pylodie in the midst of all of that. But going back to the thought about the BKBs, so, you know, if he goes for Blink Dagger and he catches everybody, then that's fantastic, but the BKB gives him the opportunity to wade into the fight, you know, even at the Lich, and be scary and not get bar struck and storm hammered. And it's also just about guaranteeing the mech and that he gets everything else off. And if for some reason somebody on C9 manages to burst the Lich, then the BKB is a guaranteed way to cast a black hole. And you know, you won't be seeing black holes typically right at the start of these fights. It's normally, oh look, I found a good opportunity on two heroes. Let's go to town.
Drawing our little graph up at the top where Eternal Envy will realize that he was only like a couple of inches too far up. He let off the Martian Machines at exactly the right time, but he was too high up that the creep wave passed through without even being affected at all. We got a 5-man smoke movement from Cloud9. They're heading up towards Roshan. Now, no one's in Roshan right now, mainly because Roshan's not there. There's no way you can see Mortal on the field anymore, but they're going to find one hero, and it's Zai. Hookshot, Dagon, rockets are flying in, Arteezy, well, he's yours up in towards the air, the March Machines will start right now. It's good cover fire, and Aoi, there he goes for the black hole. He's got Universe still trapped here. The SK's going to buy back, but it's already currently 3 heroes down, and they might find Fear. They've got him on the back end here, Fader's on the way, but a leap away for Fear. Bone7's in the tree line. And the smoke gang, very effective, not only getting 3 kills, but also having a forced buyback on the Sand King.
Yeah, the pickoffs from C9 have been really impressive. Just in terms of finding their openings, Bone7 as well, this play on Clockwork is fantastic as always, and C9 making more space on the map to, you know, secure these BKBs. They've got one up on Fada. The one on AUI was also finished and shown off in that last fight. So, no. Envy. Top tower
is under attack. Well, the epicenter burrow strike failed last time. It seems this time around it was effective. And Pylai die. I'm not quite sure what he wants to achieve here. Especially when they dropped the sentry ward. He burrow striked, but they don't have any extra detection. Pylai and I walked away from the sentry ward. So that was just a guess burrow from Zai. And instantly sentry wards are up for Pylai die, so he can do some dewarding of his own.
Just needed the arrow not to be on cooldown from fear. It's a bit unfortunate.
Where did he throw that before then?
I don't know. May have just been scouting out a little bit.
Maybe.
But yeah, it was on CD right as the burrow strike hit.
Well, right now there's some rocket spam coming out. Cloud9 have already scouted out the fact that Roshan's up. They're watching also for the ancient pull time, which Universe is just farming up quite freely with Mask of Madness, just Warcry and farm. They actually took the triple stack that C9 prepared in their own ancients before. As Fear, he found Envy. Rockets, laser, and just buy some space. He had Dagon as well, but decided to hold on to it.
Yeah. EG are about to hit a pretty big timing coming up soon with two more BKBs, one on Universe and one on Arteezy. So I think that's really what they're working towards right now, and then we'll see if they can start swinging things a little bit. Even if they win a team fight and the lanes are pushed in because C9 are keeping up the pressure really nicely, they can still maybe sneak into Roshan or win a team fight and go Roche. So, but looks like straight Roshan is the call. It has been scouted by Flare though, so we'll see if C9 are going to try and do anything.
They could give it a shot. There's another rocket on the way in, so as you said, scouted out by the Flare. Difficult to do this kind of thing without knowing what's going on. And Tinker just needs to get himself in a position where he can do a March of Machines. Now, that's a fake SK, but Clockwork is going to hookshot in. Gets the cogs off into the Blade Mount, then four stars himself back out again. It's all about distraction. Fader's on the way in, but it's a burrow strike. Epicenter Fader. He's going to melt right now. Roshan is still not dead just yet. But Razor to help get the kill with a Plasma Field. And with two heroes down, there's no way they have enough physical damage for this anymore. Roshan will belong to EG, while Zai caught out Aoi, got the Burrow Strike, Universe right behind him, able to get the Stormbolt follow-up. And the Lich ulti being committed by PPD did not want that Enigma letting up anything. It was overkill at the end of the day, but EG have Roshan, they have three kills, and all five heroes remain alive to push down the mid.
Did Fada get Burrow Struck into an arrow or something? Because his BKB didn't go off. I wasn't keeping an eye on him as he rushed into the pit there, but that was really the deciding thing in that fight, that there was that the Death Prophet just got exploded.
He got Burrow Strike before the BKB. Yep. He just walked in. Like, he's taking the damage to start with, but the Burrow Strike timing. There was also I don't think he was expecting the extra damage to come out from the Razor Plasma Field, which he probably should have been, because the Plasma Field went from inside the pit and hit him outside, so he took the damage from that almost instantly. Because it was on the way out and the way in almost exactly the same time.
Yeah, I think you can criticize Fada a little bit there for maybe not being... You know, in general, you only want to use your BKB right when you have to. You know, there's an arrow sailing towards you or something like that. But he just got... wasn't very proactive with it, you know, not very safe, and just got blown up. And it looks like I guess he also got blown up by Epicenter there. So really nicely done by Zai. Pretty much won the team fight for EG. Also nicely done by Arteezy when the Clockwork hooked in. Didn't do anything to him. Didn't, you know, waste himself on the Blade Mail, which is really good. I thought it was a little bit of a gamble for EG because they were only a few hundred gold away from Arteezy's BKB, which would have been a big deal in that fight, but still worked out really nicely for them. And now they've got the Aegis in hand to go leverage these two BKBs and maybe get some more towers.
Got a feeling Bone7 was also really sad about the timing he jumped in. I reckon he thought he got it perfectly. He could just jump in, take the Roshan kill, and then just four-star himself back out again. And instead he had to four-star out prematurely. Now, EG are going to smoke themselves up. They walked past two sentry wards that were dropped during the latest engagement. But they'll go completely undetected down south. The Rockets are keeping the split push going. Even though obviously Eternal Envy is going to be doing most of the grunt work for that. And EG, they're just looking for one person, but all of Cloud9 are back in base, apart from Pylai Dai, who's up in the trees on the top. Because I know EG's missing from every single lane. They're only just getting a glimpse now of Arteezy on the bottom, and that's why they're moving out. They move out as a five-man smoke team as well. Last time they did this, they took three kills on EG. This time they do it, We'll see if they'll be as lucky. Because Zai's
gonna
be here in the middle.
Needs to be careful with this gem.
The smoke's gonna break. Smoke breaks on Fader. Universe is here as well. And there goes your silence. He does scout out the fact that Zai is here. The jump up with the Dagon and rockets. Not enough to kill off the Sand King. He's away to safety. Doesn't lose the gem.
Yeah, I think the other factor for that last fight was there was a Sand King illusion just sitting in the trees to the west of the Roshan pit. And I think it got scouted by a flare, and C9 may have thought for a second that that was where the Sand King actually was, since the flare wasn't being thrown all the way over the pit to scout the Sand King who was actually sitting on the eastern side. And I think that's a big part of maybe why Fada got, you know, got caught out in the way that he did. And nice of Zai to survive there. Nerves of steel, I have to say, when he got silenced and managed to get out. But yeah, both teams just looking for pickoffs, trying to find that opening to start moving in towards these tier 2s. But I think EG do have the team fight advantage, assuming initiation is relatively even. The one thing that EG don't have a whole lot of is counter initiation, aside from, say, Moonlight Shadow. So if C9 do get the jump, then team fights can still definitely go their way.
Well, C9, maybe they do get the jump again. They're waiting for EG. They're just sitting back and waiting. The Tinker can keep the other lanes pressured out for the moment, but they're just waiting to jump in on anyone they can find. Paradise waiting in the tree line as Envy does the March of Machines cover fire. And EG, if they're going to do this, they will have to force the push. But they have an Aegis the Immortal on a Razor. They don't care about forcing the push. And here it comes. Not too easy. Aghanim's ulti turned on. The Crypt Swarm dragging the creep wave back off the tower. Fortification not being used by C9 just yet, as the arrow's flying down, only hitting on conversions.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
And C9 take the tower. EG take the tower, and C9 don't do anything to stop them, really.
I think C9 would have jumped.
Can do. Like, what are they? No. What are they supposed to do, man?
Well, in that situation, that C9 could have maybe jumped if EG had backed away sloppily, or if somebody had, you know, given them a good opportunity, if they'd been able to jump on, say, the Sand King or the Lich. But yeah, apart from seeing that, all they can really do is have Envy split pushing out and everybody else kind of standing around and defending. They have to try and go for some more of those smokes that they went for earlier, but do they actually have any left? There's one remaining on AUI, and there's none on the Courier. Smoke restocking in about 4 minutes, so the next two smokes are pretty crucial for C9 to see if they can get close to a tower.
They need to get something, man. This game is out of their control. I can't believe the advantage, which is also up. Like, EG are just so far ahead right now that if C9 win this, it'll be a miracle or one hell of a throw by EG.
Yeah, C9 are also waiting out the Aegis on Arteezy since it's just about to be reclaimed. So they're just kind of stalling for that to get the fight back on slightly more even terms, though they are down by 25k experience and 10k gold. So, yeah, not looking great for them right now.
EG's coming in for initiation. They're using the Moonlight Shadow. There's one hero they can catch out, but not now. He's going to blink dagger. Now he's blinking up, not even back. And EG just pushed the tier 2 tower now. Blink dagger is still there, though, and it's a smoke movement. Blink off cooldown 1 second. That's a blink BKB black hole, but PPD, notice his positioning. Staying in the side tree line, hookshot in bone 7. That's not the person he thought he was going to grab, but still it works. The Dagon kills him off, which means now Aoi, unobstructed hole. The tower will still go down, whilst Ven just mops up Eternal Envy on the sidelines.
He just foreshot
expecting
him.
Universe to jump just then.
He straight up just foreshot him. He saw the opening on Envy. Everyone else on C9 was kind of looking at the rest of EG to see who they could catch on the way out, because once they killed the Lich, they had they have the open black hole opportunity. But Envy was also looking at who they were going to jump onto next, and well, Universe jumped him first. So really nicely done there by Universe.
It is funny though, because you basically catch two heroes. Like, with their pants down, that one. Like, Aoi was in range for a blink to black hole then. And if the SD was also in range, he has a 4-star to get himself there. A defensive disruption would have been the way to go too. But at the same time, you did say 4 hits, and where's the Sven with a Mask of Madness? That's basically 1 second.
Yeah, it's like 2 seconds total, plus reaction time. You don't really have too much of an opportunity. Also, EG, EG were just pretty much in full-on retreat mode. Universe was just seeing an opportunity there. I don't think they were ever going to re-engage. They'd lost one, they lost their mech carrier, and they'd already taken what they came for, which was the tier 2 tower. So it was just up to C9 to see what else they could, what else they could grab on the retreat, but a pretty clean disengage from EG. And Eternal Envy probably needs his... I guess he does definitely need his Ghost Scepter. Now, he's actually... A lot of Tinkers will just go Dagon 1 and then straight into the Ghost Scepter, especially when there's a lot of physical damage on the enemy team. But Envy's just rushed the Dagon 5 to get as much burst as he can here. But he will probably be picking up the Ghost shortly, so he'll be a little bit less vulnerable to Universe, but there's still tons of magical damage as well for EG. I mean, we saw Envy getting soloed by an Epicenter earlier, and that's now maxed out for Zai.
I really don't understand what Cloud9 can do to get themselves back inside this game. Like, there's stall, but there's most definitely stall. Because EG don't want to go high ground, like, going into like a double march as well as a black hole. It's a danger kind of zone, but if they can just get like one or two pickoffs and have the Aghanim's ulti off cooldown for Arteezy, then they just go high ground and they win. That's as simple as this game is down to right now.
Well, the other problem is that and we've been talking about this the whole game, so I don't want to sound like a broken record, but the Death Prophet is just really a non-factor in teamfights. Everybody in EG is mech'd and frost-armored and war-cried, and there's, I think, an AC on Universe as well now, so we're talking about absolutely absurd armor totals. And the Exorcism's just not going to do anything to that, so... Unless Envy needs to be playing pretty much the game of his life from this point forward for C9 to win, and that's going to be tough because he's the only one that's worth focusing as well, aside from maybe jumping the Enigma before he BKBs, and that means he's going to get Stormhammered and Burrowstruck, and there's a Hex on Arteezy now, which is a very smart pickup, realizing that, look, the Tinker is the only relevant threat, and if I can just BKB, run at him and Hex him, that's fight over, that's game over.
They're coming. Bone 7, rockets again, gets some extra vision. Zai trying to be a bit of a blocker, but in comes Bone 7, he got Hex! Arteezy had to side the Vice up and running, and Bone 7 dies so quickly. Fader this time will have his BKB up, and as you said, minimal damage. There's your black hole! They need more damage. Envy up on top of the cliff top. Arteezy will go down. Aegis see more triggers. Universe triggers the cheese. Zai, he's too far away with an epicenter. Only one pulse really hit into Pineline Eye just then. But Arteezy back to the world of the living. The Yules are trying to buy some time for Fader, but it also buys a lot of damage in for Arteezy. 168 points of it stolen, as he does bring down the Death Prophet. And now EG with the Death of the Krob. Clockwork on the sideline. Krob can buy back. I'd say they would push up the middle lane, but look where Envy is. Pushing out the top tier 3 tower. They may just go for a race, however. Because they'll win.
Yeah, I think no doubt. Envy can push the wave up to the tower, but there's still Glyph, and Tinker's building damage is far from impressive, so... EG just gonna keep pressuring here.
Well, Midnight Pulse covers the entire mouth of the mid lane. And the Master of Machines does the same thing. Oh, this is going to be a dirty game. This is actually going to probably be even a 60-minute game right now. Because it'll take EG forever to finish against Cloud9. No matter how far ahead they get, they're still pushing against so much spam in an area of effect. It's
Shadow Poison, March, Midnight Pulse, Cogs, Rocket Flare... Crypt Swarm on a 4-second cooldown, yeah. EG, it's going to take them a little while to successfully get a creep wave up into the base, that's for sure.
It's but the ultimate dirty game. That's what this is. It's just the ultimate dirty game.
Yeah, and C9, well, if they can, you know, if they can find a big black hole, if Envy can work some magic on the Tinker, they can still definitely win a fight against EG and maybe go and, you know, equalize the buildings a little bit with the Exorcism. But that's all that it's really useful for right now.
Oh. That's I'm actually like comprehending what's gonna happen. Like, I'm trying to think 20 minutes ahead right now for C9. If you consider they just hold them back, they keep them locked down, you're gonna have an E-Blade up and running pretty shortly on a Tinker. He will have that by the 60-minute mark, so getting burst damage enough to kill off a Lich is possible, even though he is walking around with like Mech Cloak Urn. Like, PPD could potentially get picked off. As far as the Sanken getting picked off, might be a little bit more difficult, but also still a potential. And you take out these two heroes, and then what really happens to the EG teamfight? Arteezy doesn't have great control from the rest of his team. Then again, at the same time, maybe I'm looking at the wrong person here, because Universe right now is doing so much more damage than Arteezy does during the team fights.
Yeah, and once Arteezy has a refresher orb, fights are going to be ridiculously difficult for C9. We're talking about at least, you know, 8 or 10 seconds of BKB every time, 2 Hexes, 2 Eye of the Storms. I just don't know what they're going to be able to do against that. So they have to try and, if they can, hopefully catch out Arteezy, you know, before he pops his first BKB, but that's going to be very, very tough. And EG are just going to keep on piling on more BKBs. We've even got one for Zai now. So the Tinker is the only way that C9 can win team fights, and, well, EG are doing everything that they can to make life difficult for Envy.
Oh, they're coming up right now. Malivus done. Arteezy, hookshot in. EG's coming in as support on the Moonlight Shadow will go. They'll need some vision, and then double stun from Universe. He cleaves apart the Tinker in the SD while a Burrow Strike from Zai holding out. Yeah, he doesn't want to use a Black Hole just for that. While Fader, well, he will finally die inside the tree line. Hexed up by Arteezy. Universe is right behind him. They will clean him up. And, well, Bone 7 gets back to base, but he's lost his entire team. That is not the fight Cloud9 wanted. They want a quick pick off on Arteezy and just get the hell out of Dodge, but EG, they had 4 heroes right behind him. Well, I won't say right behind him. They're lagging by 2 seconds, but they still came.
Universe, what a player. This guy is just doing everything for EG right now, honestly. He's finding the clutch pickoffs. He pressured the map during the early game with his Blink Dagger. EG owe a lot to Universe's play this game, but also just PPD's draft is under attack. I think phenomenal against, they kind of baited C9 into taking the Death Prophet and had a plan up their sleeve.
Brainstorm is waiting for some kind of like moment to go in. They want to see Aoi 2000 up, however. And for one of the guys in the chat, who I actually forgot his name now, but he was like, man, Toby, you're so stupid, this game won't go to 60 minutes. EG just got a 4 kill for, what, 0 trade-off? And all they could do was bring the tier 3 tower down to 127 life points. This is why I'm thinking this is still going to go to a 60-minute game. I wasn't expecting Cloud9 to do this, though. I was expecting Cloud9 to go up and try and find a gank, but not before they had a support go up and give them vision, so they could understand what they were really getting themselves into. That was like the blind leading the blind on that gank on the top lane.
Well, they're never going to have any vision because EG have a gem right now, so...
Shoot a Fader. Universe. Fader's in a lot of trouble. He never got the BKB off. Yule Scepter, 4-star away. Now, Yule Scepter will go up. Hookshot in from Bone 7, pushing Universe back. He's out of mana as well. And Fader did use the BKB just in case so he could retreat out. And that means BKB's on cooldown, but they keep the crop alive.
Radiant's bottom tower. EG weren't even planning, I think, on going too much further after that. Arteezy's still farming top lane, I think, to start working on his refresher. So it was just like, oh, hey, look, we have an Invis rune. Let's see if we can do anything cool with it. And they still, at the very least, do get another BKB charge out of Vada, knocking it down to 6 seconds.
Oh, Envy. Arteezy, he's going to have enough damage to bring him down. Go Scepter so we can't at least attack him. But Zai, perfect timing. And Envy is screwed. And that's a big screw up too, because now they've got 74 seconds on the sideline for the Tinker. He bought back to defend the last push. Maybe we won't reach 60 minutes, because they won't have a big Marshall Machine wave to keep him out.
Why is Envy staring at Arteezy like that in the lane? I don't quite get it.
It was confidence, man.
He can't kill you by himself. I mean, he can't kill you by himself, but you can't kill him. Either. I guess maybe you can force him to BKB if he feels threatened, but it's not like he has E-Blade Dagon. It's just Dagon 5, so... I don't know about that play there from Envy. Especially as you pointed out that he bought back previously, so now it's 30 seconds of no Tinker, EG, open invitation into the C9 base.
Yep, and they're attacking both mid as well as top. The Raindrax is gone already. Bone 7, the Cogswell, they're far enough away from every hero, they don't even care about it. And Arteezy, that ultimate, is tearing through the melee racks. Attempted hookshot, but now stunned up, burrowed up. He'll have to have a defensive disruptor to try and save him. As Bone 7 getting hookshot away, one charge to keep him alive. Actually, sleeping one charge, that was the mech. And he dies anyway. This is over. This won't even hit 50 minutes. Like, Fair triggers the ultimate. EG will back up for the moment because Tinker is also respawning. But they got a full mid racks. They got a melee up on top. They Moonlight Shadow. And so they're waiting for just one person to be out of range. And already Envy is trying to do a split push. He's down the bottom lane, attacking into the tier 2 tower down there. EG might back up to defend this, or they just say screw it. Fear, yeah, he finishes the range racks up on top. It's a full double raxing now. TZ will defend on this bottom lane. So maybe EG just force out the bottom lane and that's it. That's all they gotta do. Just straight drive now.
Yeah, there's not really much standing in their way. Arteezy has 6k gold. Just sitting in a pile right now. He's going to be picking up his refresher orb in just a second. And with that, yeah, I think C9's done.
It's, can't look at the bright side of this place. There is no bright side if you're a C9 fan. If you're an EG fan, you're loving this because now they're basically one win away from forcing out a second best of three and deciding matchup. That's exactly what EG wants to at least have. Probably what a lot of the viewers want to have as well. Keep the games extended. More games. More games. Because we have a potential of 6 games that can be played out today. We had a minimum of 2, a maximum of 6. A scheduling nightmare.
Yeah, for sure. But I really like the format. I mean, it's only you can only do it if you have a separate day dedicated to the grand finals. But it's also... I know we don't really see it too much in Dota, but it's still, I think it's still really cool. Maybe it would get sick of it if we did it all the time. Ooh, Zai.
C9 realized where he went to. Unfortunately, he didn't attack him early enough. They didn't reach him in time. The rockets flew in, but he was able to blink himself back down again. And now, Burrow Strike. They got Bone 7 out of position. He won't get his cogs up. In fact, he just gets destroyed. Universe, way too much damage. Murano is actually the one to take the kill right there with the Daedalus. I was wondering where those crits are coming from because there's no Daedalus over on Universe. It's over on Fear, who Moonlight Shadows to try and find a nice line, but he's looking for a nice arrow. And he'll find Fader. They got Pylite die, and now Enigma jumps in. It's a two-man black hole, but PPD waited out perfectly. Let's Lich ult, he goes. A double buyback now coming up, but they got nothing else to fight with. GG is the call. 49 minutes into the game. And EG will take game one here in our first best of three. Because they're coming from the lower bracket, they're having to do it the rough way. They must win a best of three to force a second best of three to go for the grand final prize, which is just shy of $100,000 for Dota 2. But they're off to a very good start. And Cloud9, that's a rocky start. That's a very, very rocky start.
I mean, I feel like Envy just drafted right into to what PPD had planned. It was the exact same thing, in the EG game against Newbie, where they just sort of hung the Shadow Shaman and the Lycan in front of them and said, "Look, I know you want it," and they took it. And then PPD just had had a plan ready to go to beat it down. So we've seen that EG is not afraid of Lycan. They're not necessarily afraid of the Death Prophet either. And I don't know. I also feel that there was a little bit of reactionary drafting out of C9. Maybe I think most notably in the Shadow Demon pick, but PPD seems cool, calm, and collected. And I think for the first time this tournament, it seems like Envy's getting pressured on the draft. I think he's won most of his drafts up until this point, and that's been a big source of wins for them. So we'll see if things change up for game two, if Envy can get a better handle on what PPD is up to.
Yeah, well, we'll see how it goes. So stay tuned, everybody. We'll have a short break, and the players will grab themselves a beverage. And we'll be back here for game number two in just a moment.